11:01. Okay, I will cut the message by 1:25. Y'all believe that? Say oh me. Anyway, good to see you this morning. Glad you're here. Looking forward to God speaking to our hearts. I'll say this to you. I'll go ahead and say it now. This is one of the most important messages you'll ever hear in your life. And it's just truth. I've said that almost every message, haven't I? On the Sermon on the Mount. And really, the whole Sermon on the Mount. How appropriate, if you'll pay attention, and I'll pay attention today, you'll see how appropriate this message is for today. And really, we say this, but I don't know, well, I'm speaking for myself, whether we fully believe this, but the Bible is more up to date than today's newspaper.
Amen.
This is just truth, folks, that we have to... Now, again, do we believe that? Probably not. But it doesn't matter, does it?
No.
We make this statement, I've made it, you've probably made it, maybe. God said it, I believe it, so it's so. No. That's faulty. That is faulty. That's a faulty statement. It's God said it. Therefore it's so.
Amen.
It don't matter whether you and I believe it. Don't matter if anybody else believes it. God said it. It's so. Right?
Amen.
God didn't ask you and I our opinions when he said, let there be light. He just said, let there be light, and it was so. And everything that he did, it was so, it was so, so, so. Why? Because God said it. He didn't say whether or not you and I believed it or not. And so, boy, we got to escape that, don't we? And that takes a lifetime. And help us, help us, help us. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we're grateful to be here this morning. We do pray you'd speak to our hearts. Certainly when we preach and teach the Bible, the most important book, the book. The Apostle Paul, when he was in prison, he asked to bring his books. But he said, especially the parchment, especially the Word of God. And Father, really, well, it's reality. All he had was the Old Testament. We say all he had was the Old Testament. How important is the Old Testament? It's the Word of God.
Amen.
And we have seen in the Old Testament what you did for your people. And we've seen your people turn away from you so many times. And yet you had mercy, love, and compassion upon them. And that's what we're asking you to do for us. Father, help us in this service to focus on you and you alone. Father, because you're speaking to us individually, and we want to hear what you have to say to us from your word, and we ask that you help us. Guide us and direct us, and thank you for those that are here, and we pray, God, that you would speak to our hearts through song, through your word, and we trust that you're going to do the work as only you can. We pray this in Jesus' wonderful name, for his sake. Amen.
All right, Brother Randy. All right. Any trouble saying that?
I say that every Sunday.
Okay, you would get your hymnal this morning and turn to hymn number 508. 508, and Darrell's already said he didn't want me to sing a solo this morning, so
wow.
I'll sing out and help me out.
You just said 508, I said, no, this is me.
Love lifted me.
singing, Brother Jesse, you pray for us, please, sir.
Dear Lord, thank you for this wonderful day. Thankful I could come short. That's what you give picture of because of food. Give us the healing. Thank you for everything you've done, everything you're going to do. Please thank
you. Amen. Amen. Well, if anybody needs a locksmith, that would be me. I'm a locksmith. Somebody locked my study door and somewhere along the line, and a few weeks back, maybe it was last week or week before, and I completely forgot that they had locked it. And I came to get in it this morning, and I was like, oh my goodness, I'm not able to get in here. So I did the most logical thing. I tried a piece of paper to put in there, and it didn't work. And then I said, you know what, I got some little things in my wallet that maybe I get that thing open. But then I did the most logical thing you ought to do. What did I do?
Pray.
I prayed. That's right. I prayed about it. I said, Lord, if you want this door open, now I'm really no locksmith. But anyway, I said, if you want it open, you get it open. And so I slid this thing in there and brought it down, hit the thing, and it opened up. So, anyway, you know, God could have kept that thing closed.
Amen.
He could have. This is so hard for us to, including me, you folks. Listen, it's one of those things. It's hard for us to, we're never going to figure it out, the sovereignty of God. You know, God's in control. He's in control of all things. We need to trust Him. We need to think about ourselves and not others. Now, we need to think about others when it comes to trying to help them. And I was going to speak on this when we do our prayers, when we talk about prayer. But the most best thing you can do, and I can do for anybody, is what?
Pray.
Is pray for them. Right? It's not giving them advice, and it's not that God doesn't want us to give advice. He does. There's times God wants us to share and all these different things. But the best thing that we can do for each other is pray for one another. Lift each other up in prayer. You know, and Brother Richie had said one time that Adrian Rogers said, if you're going to be, don't criticize anybody. Now, you shouldn't criticize at all, but he said, if you're going to be critical, you better pray for him. At least pray for him. And he said, you know what? When you start praying for him, you'll stop being critical of him. Really, folks, that's what we need more, right?
Yeah.
So, that's my first message. All right. Paul Price is our teacher of the week. You appreciate him. Say amen.
Amen.
Amen. We appreciate Paul and all of our teachers. Continue to lift them up in prayer, and encourage them, and then myself and my family, the missionaries of the month, and certainly need to witness and be a testimony out in the world to in our community, in our Jerusalem here, and so pray God would help us with that. And then Mark Robinson is our lieutenant governor, and certainly want to pray for him. Appreciate his stance and where he is and all of that, and seems to be a real good man.
Amen.
And has a desire again for right, and you know, in things that pray for him, lift him up. Pittsburgh Police Department, and say that because there's not a whole lot of folks. Let's just be honest. There's not a whole lot of folks out there, you know. Again, with the message of Christianity, and have a desire for that. And Pittsburgh Fire Department, Police Department, I want to pray for them, lift them up to the Lord in prayer. And then again, mark on your thing there. Since, again, we don't have a whole lot of people here today, there is in the back a little thing on the teachers and officers. Pick one of those up if you want. A very minimal change on that. I believe Andrea is going to, she's on there for 3 and 4 year olds teaching. Aiden, and then Jeremy is going to be second after Randy, and then Mike will be under him as far as leading the music. And of course, I think Richie's coming off. Paul, you're coming on. Yeah, he doesn't know. But anyway, so I don't have it in front of me. But anyway, that's back there. You take a look at it. Just want to give you an opportunity. It was out there for last week. Of course, we didn't have service, and so we'll vote on it next Sunday night. So just change that on your bulletin there. We'll do the move up the Sunday after that. So anyway, God's in control of all that too. Hey, Matt, and we'll just allow him to work. And again, glad you're here.
Hymnals again, turn to hymn number 492. Let's see that. Calvary.
Sim filling in today.
Amen.
Appreciate them doing that for us and did a good job. We certainly appreciate them doing it. All right, do pray for Randy and Lisa. Continue to pray for them as they continue to recover. Both of them doing better. Really had a tough time, especially Lisa did, really. And, of course, Randy, both of them not having a lot of energy. Of course, Karen also. Just continue to lift her up. She's doing better herself. And she's been isolated in a room by herself, and so she'll be glad to get out of that. And so do pray for them if you would. And also, Coach from Rocky Mount texted me this morning. His wife, Kristen, has COVID, and he wanted me to pray for her. He says she's in great health, you know, everything, but she's just kind of concerned and has some anxiety about it, so wanted us to pray for her, so lift her up. And excuse me. Let's see. William, I'm not forgetting somebody.
Brother Tony.
Yes, Brother Tony. In this, got, I guess you'd call stampeded by a calf and messed his shoulder up. He's going to have shoulder surgery, I believe, on September the 3rd. And so lift him up to the Lord in prayer. There is really a lot of pain. Paul tells me we'll try to keep contact with him and talk with him about that. So just lift him up to the Lord in prayer if you would. All right, any other requests?
Suzanne.
Yes, sorry, thank you. Appreciate that. Continue to pray for Suzanne. Continue to lift her up to the Lord in prayer. Also, Noah Helbling, continue to pray for him as he recovers. Excuse me. Yes, Grace. I mentioned to you earlier, let's lift each other up in prayer. That's the best thing you can do for anybody. And, you know, just different things going on in our society, you know all about it. And the main thing is that we pray for each other, lift each other up, and just ask God to help us to make biblical decisions, what He would have us to do in all of these things. We have to trust Him. And when I say that, we have to trust Him. I mean, that. This is, I remember Ian Thomas saying, it's really a, and it is, if we really thought about it, it's a reproach on God, you know, to talk about trusting God. I mean, and calling somebody a great man of faith when it's coming to trusting God. Now, you would be a great man or woman of faith to trust me. Now, that would be a whole lot of faith because I'm a man, I'm a human. But to trust God, it's, right? I mean, God's God. He's who He says He is. He's worthy of our trust, and we should all trust Him, right? Amen. And so, boy, we just need to ask God to help us with that, and all of us certainly know that we lack in some of these things, and so we need to just pray and ask God to help us there. Good news for, I knew there was something else for Deanna Kiger. She's out of the hospital. Steve wasn't able to see her for 14 days. And anyway, just glad to hear that from him. So excited that she's gotten better. The doctor told her this, that, and I know it's God, ultimately, who we pray to that saw fit to this, but he said to her, it's just a miracle. He said, you should have been in here 1 to 2 more weeks. Sending you home today is a miracle. And God's still in the miracle business.
Amen.
It's a blessing. And I understand, folks, as we all understand, some people are healed, some people are not. But God is sovereign. He's in control of all of these things. And we must again, trust Him and allow Him to work in our hearts and our lives. And so that was a real blessing. And so continue there to pray for her healing as she continues to heal. And I I know Steve is excited, you know, about that, of course, and so continue to pray for them. And also Steve, and again, they've, you know, been out of church for a while, just a lot of things going on, just interesting how that took place too, and, but anyway, that's just another story. Brother Sam, pray for us, please, sir, if you would.
Our blessed God and Heavenly Father, we are so thankful to be able to come into thy presence, not because we deserve audience with thee or have earned even an ounce of respect, but because of thy grace, you allow us to come before thee.
Amen.
Father, we're so thankful for the lesson that we had before this service, and the words of Nebuchadnezzar, who said, there is no other God who can deliver after this sort. Nebuchadnezzar had learned that lesson, and how we need to learn that lesson as well. Father, we don't always know exactly what the deliverance means. We think of, as we also heard in Sunday school, of the three Hebrews who ended up in the fiery furnace. And they said, our God can deliver us, and if not, he knows what's best. And Father, we need to have the same sort of courage and confidence in thee as our God as well. We're so thankful that you know all of our needs, all that have been mentioned and all that are unspoken. Our Father, we are thankful that you are in control of all things. We just need to bow the knee to thee. We need to give you the opportunity to be God instead of trying to be a substitute for thee. Erwin Luther said, the true test of value, the true test of worthiness, is if something can be substituted. And if there's no other substitute, then that one thing becomes invaluable. And God, you are invaluable to us. Because there is no one like thee. There was no one who can be substituted for thee, and yet mankind, and I include myself, spend so much time trying to find a replacement for thee in pleasure, in our activities, our choices, our wills, our determination that we're going to have our way. Our Father, we realize that none of those substitutes are any good because you alone can be God. You alone are God. Thank you for hearing us this morning. Thank you for meeting with us as we gather around thy word. Our Father, we would pray that you would open our ears to hear your voice.
Yes.
Open our minds to understand your word. And open our hearts so that we will obey whatever you say to us this morning. For we ask it in the worthy and precious name of the one who gave himself for us that we might have this access into thy presence, even the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Appreciate that, brother. As you turn in your Bibles to Matthew chapter 6, Matthew chapter 6, of course, we weren't here last week, and so we want to kind of go back to what we were saying 2 weeks ago, and the importance of this thing of, we asked you the question, what would you title the message? And of course, I know it's been 2 weeks, so you might not remember, but it was really this term, take no thought. Really, it's about anxiety. I actually, somebody shared this with me. I think it was Karen that shared with me this, and so you can look this up for yourself. But one of the top four reasons for people getting into the hospital with COVID, believe it or not, this is just what they say, is anxiety. Anxiety. That a lot of this, and matter of fact, when Karen told us this, she was telling this other lady, and this lady sent a thing from her friend who the doctor, her doctor, said part of her problem was her anxiety over this. That it really, anxiety in your body causes all kinds of other problems Amen. Within you. And that's amazing, isn't it? Now, here's the thing. Our Creator God knew all this before anybody else discovered it. If you read Days of Praise today, excellent Days of Praise today, about water and wind and all these things, and I can't remember the time that they discovered, right, these things, but God in Job said all these things before they ever discovered it. And so I've said this to you before, and I'll say it again. Truth is not discovered. You know, truth has always been there.
Amen.
Amen. That's right. God is truth. Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, the life. With the, my Greek is failing me right now, but what that is called, the, it's not a truth, it's not a life, and not a way, it is the, what is that in the Greek? Anyway, the something or another's there. It's not coming to my mind. Because I already told you, I'm not a Greek scholar. But truth, truth. And so, really, today, what we need to see in our society and in our own lives is, when we worry, really, we're it's false for the believer. Now remember, the Sermon on the Mount is written to Christians. It's written to the believer. You know, Satan would love, and matter of fact, there's people, scholars that say the Sermon on the Mount is not for today's believer. That's insane. Now, I don't care how scholarly they are. This is for us. And I'm not scholarly, but I'm telling you, this is for us. It's in the Bible. The Bible says all scripture, right? Amen?
Amen.
It's for us. And so here, we would all say, I believe that we struggle with worry, with anxiety. How is it going to turn out, right? Because we don't know. The unknown is hard, isn't it? It's very difficult to grasp. And so what do? We do exactly what Sim prayed. We try to control the circumstances and do everything we can to make it happen. But yet God says, don't do that. Don't have no thoughts. And again, remember what we said? He goes from the lesser to the greater. Now, of course, in salvation, praise God, He gave us, we talked about this 2 weeks ago, He gave us the greater. Right? Remember we went to Romans chapter 8? If God spared not His only Son, how shall He not freely, right, give us all things?
Amen.
Right? And so, here, though Jesus in the Sermon on the Mount, He goes from the lesser things in life to the great. And of course, speaking of you and me, and He's going to do that again in this passage of Scripture. Now, remember again, this is written to believers. This is not the world. The world does not have faith. Well, they have faith. It's in the wrong things.
Amen.
But they don't have spiritual God faith that you and I have here in this life. And so 2 weeks ago, we looked at the fowls of the air. And today we're gonna read that particular, we're gonna go back into verse number 25 and read from there. But today we want to get into the considering the grass and the lilies, the flowers. We want to talk about that today and what it means to us. Look at verse number 25. And again, always, this is a great study tool for you and for me when you're reading the Bible. The word therefore or wherefore, you need to know why it's therefore or wherefore. The meaning of it is what he's already said. So you got to go back into that, right? He's already told us, spiritually speaking, we should give, we should pray, we should fast. We should do all these things. Then he's told us already that lay not up for yourselves treasures on earth, but lay up for yourselves treasures in heaven, right? He's already told us that. He's also told us that you cannot, right? Now that's pretty plain, isn't it? You cannot serve God in mammon, right? Now, I want to stop right there for just a minute. I don't remember if I said this 2 weeks ago, but the Bible tells us that the love of money is the root of all evil. And really, it's talking about various kinds of evil. And really, when you look at things today in our society, money, again, pretty much, is behind all of these things. Now, it would be revolutionary, wouldn't it, if we just believe God? This is not something, God said this. Most people today are about money. They want your money. They want to use your money to what? Better themselves in their lives. And so most all these things that are going on, if not all of them, in back of it is money. But Jesus says you cannot serve God and money or anything else for that matter. Right? Amen? And so then it comes to this, therefore, because of all that, what you need to do is consider some things. Now, here's what people are... Listen, faith is not a shot in the dark. Do you realize faith takes thinking? Right? Listen to me, folks. Worry is a sin for the believer. The unbeliever can't help but worry. He has no security. He has nothing. But what did we say about Matthew 6? Who is the main character in Matthew 6?
Father.
The Father. The relationship that you have with your Father. You got to keep that in mind over and over and over again. You have to remind yourself you have a Father. Amen. He's your God. But it's more personal, right? He is your Father. Amen. And he will take care. It's not a matter. He will take care of you. No doubt about that. Whether you trust him or not, God still takes care of us, even in our untrust. But it's so much better to trust him and be faithful and allow him to work in your heart and life. So, really worry for the believer. You're not really thinking. You see, faith takes thinking. And thinking how, Pastor? You're going to like this. Logically. You say, what? Logically? I'm talking about the believer. Right? I'm not talking about the world. The world uses this term. Well, it's just logical, right, to do this or do that. Let me tell you something for the believer. The most logical thing that you can do is to trust God.
Amen.
Right? Just listen, that's the most logical thing a believer can do is trust God with everything. Why? Because he's your Father. He's God. And here's the amazing part about you and me. And we're all guilty of this, just as simple. We're all guilty of this. We actually trust God for the greater, our eternal life, right? Have you trusted Jesus Christ, his death, his burial, and his resurrection for your salvation?
Amen.
Have you done that? That's the greatest, listen, that's the greatest thing you could ever do. And yet, we refuse. We believe on him for salvation, right? But we don't believe him for our everyday lives. Now tell me that's not illogical. Now folks, listen, and that's why it takes thought, right? I'm here today, so we'll think. And think how, Pastor? Logically. And this is what Jesus is telling us here. You need to start thinking. Right? That's our problem. It's not that we're not thinking. People actually think that they're thinking when they're worried. And they're really not. They're not thinking. I hope I'm making sense to you folks. I really am. Because listen, if we don't get this, we're in trouble. Because we really think we're thinking. And we're really not. When we're not thinking about our Father and Him being in control of everything. And so, he goes into that. We talked about the fowls in the air. And so, here he says, therefore, and so he says, take no thought for your life. Verse 25. What ye shall eat or what ye shall drink, nor yet for your body, what ye shall put on. Is not life more than meat, and the body than raiment? That's what he's saying. Is life not more important? Remember, we talked about this 2 weeks ago. More important than the food that you drink or the clothes that you wear. That's the thought process here. Of course, man. Most people, what do? Eat, drink. We talked about that 2 weeks ago. Eat, drink, and be merry. And I'll be satisfied. But you're never satisfied with that. You always want more. There's more commercials about food and about clothing, right? Isn't it amazing how these fads come back in? And I've said this before with basketball. I hope and pray that we never go back to the 70s and in the 80s where they wore their short shorts as basketball players. Oh, my soul. But they thought that was cool. Yikes. Please, let's not go back to that. But it might. That'd be bad, wouldn't it? It would. It'd be terrible. These fashions, they come and they go. Right? I change. Why? Because people aren't satisfied. I don't look right. And we've talked about all that. And so here he says, is it not more important? He said, behold the fowls of the air. Verse 26. For they sow not, neither do they reap, nor gather into barns. Yet your heavenly Father, there it is again, feedeth them. Are ye not much better than they? It's a question that you need. You must, folks, listen. We've got to ask this question. Now, according to PETA, you know, the animal rights people and all these crazies out there, you know, and all. Well, okay, I probably shouldn't have said that, but let me just back up and take that off the tape, whoever's the editor. But they think animals are just as important as you are. Not true.
They actually think more.
They do think, and most your average Christian thinks more. You know, people have left this church. Now, they've been gone for a good while because they thought I said their dog wasn't important. They said I was preaching that their dog was more important. And I said that. I'm like, what? All I said is people treat their dogs better than they do human beings. Is that not true? That's all I said. Now, I wasn't even talking about this person in particular, but evidently they thought it was. You know what I told me? They treated their dog better than people. Now, I'm trying to be honest with you. That's just truth. I wasn't even thinking about them. I didn't even know how they treat their dog. Right? But God did. That's crazy, isn't it? But hey, we can tell you story after story after story with stuff like this. And I have no clue what's going on in your life. But God does. And yet I'm the one, hey. But it's okay. What do I have to do? I've said God's in control. He knows these things. And I just got to preach truth. And the truth of the matter is, God says here in His Word, are ye not more important than an animal? The answer to that question is, yes, you are. This is not about treating animals bad. Come on, folks. Now, I didn't ask God to put me in a chicken house. I did not ask God for this work. He gave it to me. Now, here's an amazing thing about this. I'm thinking God's allowing me to do this so I can get out of debt quicker. And that's my desire, so I can help more. And then this past week, I got a bill from the IRS telling me I didn't make the mistake. They made the mistake. They gave me too much money. They didn't give me anything, but they said they're charging me $1,100. Now, my first response is, man, what in the world? On this, you know, this rebate credit thing. Evidently, there's something on it. They gave me seven reasons why this could have happened. They didn't give me the reason. They gave me seven reasons why. And so I had no clue what happened. So I called. Oh, you know how it is. On hold, on hold, on hold. And then they come back, and this is what the recorder said. We're too busy today. We don't have time to answer your particular question. Please call back tomorrow. Now, I'm supposed to pay this by September 13th. And I'm imagining they're going to run me out on this thing. But you know how my response should be. You know what it should be. Now, God, you knew this all along. And so I just got, evidently I didn't know this either. You get 25% of your what they project you might make. So they just gave me that. You know when they gave me that? This week. I was getting ready to put it on some debt until I got that letter. I said, wait a minute. Maybe God's telling me I need to use this for this. And if it's all this is true, now I want you to pray with me that it's not true and that somehow or another I'll get. But you know how it is with the RS. You don't usually get out of it. You usually got to pay. Right? And so, but God knew all this. He's in control. Now, I'm just being honest with you because that's what I'm supposed to be, right? I'm like, I don't want to pay this. I wasn't working in the chicken house for this. But God knew all that. He's in control. I got to trust. Here, just again. Do you hear what I was getting ready to say? I got to trust him. That's pathetic. I'm just being honest with you, right? And so here, again, you know, God's not telling us, again, to treat animals. I said all that to say, you know, some things you got to do in the chain house, people don't even know about. It's just the way it is. Between life and death. Yeah, it's just part of life, you know. But you're not, anyway. God hasn't called us to treat animals mean-spirited. But animals are not as important as you are.
That's right.
Amen.
That's
right.
And so he says in verse number 27, which of you, again, taking thought, okay, can add one cubit to his stature? Now we mentioned this could be a couple different things. It could be your life and what your life is, or it could be your actual height. Who can think, you know, John and I talked about this plenty of times. I was like this when I was young, and I was a pretty decent athlete, but never tall, 5'11", well, always said I was 6 foot. But I was really probably 5'10½", something like that. But, you know, I said, man, I wished a lot. He wishes a lot. We all wish a lot. Hey, man, I wish I would have been taller. Could I make myself taller by that? No, hey, I can do like most people do. I can get in there and put my head up on the wall, you know, make those little marks and stuff. And man, kind of go up a little bit. But did that make me any taller? No. The wall says I'm 6'3". But life says I'm still 5'10½". Bummer, isn't it? Not really. It shouldn't be. Because it's the way God made me. I can't take a thought and make myself taller. I can't make my life any different other than trusting God, right? If God wanted me to be 6'10", so be it. But he chose not to. And so here, by taking thought, really, what is he trying to say? Can you really change anything in your life as far as your life is concerned, quote unquote? Can you? No, God's in control of all of these things. You can't. Now you think, here's the problem, we think we can. But I'm just telling you, God's plan is going forth. You say, how does he work all that out? Well, you'll just have to ask him when you get there because I don't have a clue. Daryl and I were talking about this back there, the sovereignty of God. And giving people leeway. That's what church is supposed to be. We're supposed to all have soul liberty and choice. But we need to make sure that the choice that we're making is that we're trusting God, right?
Amen.
And so our thought pattern needs to be, hey, I can't. And so this is what he says in verse 28. And why take ye thought of raiment? Why are you thinking about? Now, it used to be that ladies were worse than guys. But it's just not that way today, man. I'll tell you, guys, today, I have never in my life seen, I told you this before, and I'm going to say it again. When I played basketball, man, I went to play basketball. It wasn't how I looked. It was how good I was on the court. Now you got to have the right shoes. Man, you got even guys that buy two pairs of shoes, wear one on one side, one on another. Again, you do whatever you want to do. But, man, we're trying to be cool and all these other kind of things. And, hey, you got to wear slides or you got to wear flip-flops or you got to do this. You don't come prepared to play basketball. You come prepared to be looked at. You got to make sure, man, I'm styling when I walk in the gym. Right? And God says, why are you doing all that? He said, well, is there anything wrong with that, Pastor? I don't know. You got to take that over God. But if that's what your whole concern about is, there's something wrong with it. He says, why do you think about what you're going to wear? And so he says this, consider the lilies of the field, how they grow. They toil not, neither do they spin. And yet I say unto you, and that's what's important, isn't it? Amen. That even Solomon, in all of his glory, was not arrayed like one of these. This is so important. Have you ever looked at Solomon's kingdom? Have you ever gone back and seen? I mean, the silver and the gold and the guard. I mean, just the whole shebang. Have you ever read Ecclesiastes? You read this and what Solomon says about his kingdom and how it was. I mean, you're talking about gardens. You're talking about, hey, where's, there he is. I've learned something new about Dalton today. I'm going to throw Dalton right under the bus. I'm not going to run over you twice, so I'm just going to throw you under there. Paul asked him, he said, how's the landscaping business going? Am I telling the truth? And Dalton, he set us all straight. He said, man, I'm in the gardening business. Now, there's a difference in the landscaping business, gardening. Now, I'm going to get, after the service is over, I'm going to get Dalton up here, and he's going to explain that to me. Now, you and I think it's all the same, right? Right? But you can't imagine what Solomon's garden, I mean, he talks about this, all the stuff that he had. I mean, you're talking about it was a raid, buddy. But Jesus said, the time, and there was some, you realize there was some time spent. There's some time spent in gardening, isn't it? That's why it's different landscape, man. Just throw that stuff out of gardening, man. You gotta put your hands on it, man. Do some good stuff there. But God is saying here, that's what he did with the lilies. Now, this is amazing. You can do this on your own, and I would advise it. Do some study. You want to really think about what God is saying here and really have some good thought about it? Do some study on flowers in Palestine, in the Holy Land. You know what you'll find out? You'll find out a lot of our domesticated flowers come out of that place in Palestine. It's amazing. And now, no scholar really knows what he's talking about here. He put the word lily here, but in our mind, what do we think about? The lilies that we have here? Probably not, really. Probably some type of flower that came out of the daisy family. Do you realize there's 20,000 different kinds of flowers that come out of the daisy? What does that mean, Pastor? What does it mean? What is Jesus really saying to us here? He spent a lot of time. Now you say, what? I don't even understand all this. He spent a lot of time thinking about flowers. In the details. All the little, how you say that word? Intricate. Intricacies, yeah, that word. That's why you need to be up here. And the details of a flower. Just a flower. Right? That's what he's saying. Do you get that? He said, listen, this. He said, behold the fowls. He said, consider the lilies. This word has the idea of what? Taking some time. Really putting some thought process in this. That's why I did. Man, it was too much. I'm just being honest with you. Looking at these flowers in Israel. It was too much. Just overwhelmed with what? What? All these different flowers. And for the most part, all of them annuals. Now, you know what an annual is, right? I know that. It comes and doesn't come back. A preannual does what? Preannual? That's what it's called, isn't it?
Oh, perennial.
Perennial. I'll say, hey, see, man, I got the gardener here to help me. Thank you, brother. They come back every year. But you know, most of the wild, these flowers, they're annuals. And yet, God, listen to me. This is what he's trying to say to you. He spent a lot of time. Now, when I say that, it's just hard, isn't it? In God's mind, it's his way. Because he said, let there be light, and there was light. I mean, 6 days, he made everything. So, yeah, that's just beyond our comprehension, isn't it? You see what I'm saying? And so he's saying, consider just the lily, just the flower. And all of the details of it. Right? Just consider it. And he says this. Then go back in the Old Testament. Okay? and consider Solomon's kingdom. And I'm telling you, folks, you go, now, Daisy, you know, Solomon's kingdom. There's not a person going to say, oh, man, I'll take Daisy. Right? But God says there was more detail in that one flower than everything that Solomon did to make his kingdom the way it was. Whew. That's vast, isn't it? And this is what he's trying to get us to think. Okay, good. What does that mean? You're more important than the lily. So in other words, you think God can't take care of you?
Amen.
I mean, if one flower, the lilies, if they are more splendid than Solomon's kingdom, can God not take care of you and clothe you? Right? Don't you see that faith takes thinking? Don't. You know what the world says to you? They say you're a crackpot. Who would believe there's a God? Well, I'll tell you who believe a God. A smart person.
Amen.
A logical person would believe in God and trust God. Amen. But they'll say, oh, man. Listen. Don't trust me. Trust Jesus. The most logical thing you can do is trust Him with your life, with whatever you do in life. You see, the world's going to say, oh man, hey, I need, listen to me. I need evidence. Right? I follow the science. Well, if you follow the science, you ain't following it very well. Because there's nothing in science that goes against God and His Word.
Amen.
They're still trying to figure out stuff that God already knows. Amen. Help us. So he says, listen, God clothes these things. He said, there's not a thing that was not arrayed like one of these. Even Solomon's glory. Man, I tell you, flowers. Now, and that's what I'm saying. They're so gardening. I mean, it's a beautiful thing. These flowers and all the different details about them, they're amazing. I almost said creatures. They're amazing flowers. It's just amazing. And really, you see beyond the flower, and you see a designer. You see God that took time to develop. And if He can develop these flowers, and here's the thing, for just here today, gone tomorrow, can He not take care of your everyday needs? Yes, He can. And so he goes on. Then he says, now, there's this word again. Wherefore, okay, verse 30. If God so clothed the grass of the field, which today is and tomorrow is cast into the oven. Now, this is important, too, here. You know, the Bible has a lot about that said. And, of course, this would go with Israelite culture and things. Now, you realize, now praise be to God, folks, listen, that God wants to relate to us. The problem's not with God. The problem's with you and me. God wants to relate to us. And listen to me, God wants us to understand. He really does. All through the scriptures, Jesus gave illustrations for people to understand what he was trying to say. And here, this is I didn't know this until studying it. And I know I've read this in the past, but it's been a long time ago since I did the Sermon on the Mount. So I did know it, but I've forgotten it, right? Like we all do. But they would take this grass, and they would cut it and they would dry it out, real dry, sort of like what we talked about here. And they'd put it in the oven and get the fire of the oven burning and get it real hot. And then they would remove it and they'd put their bread in there and they would cook their bread. And so what Jesus is saying here is giving them a real illustration, again, of life, of grass. You know, it's here today and it's gone tomorrow. It's of use But again, its use comes and then it's gone. And what he's trying to say to you and me is, listen, your use is much greater than a flower or than grass. Because they're all going away. God has put more details in you, mankind, and me than he has in anything else. You, let me tell you this, are important. There's only one reason. Because of God. The only thing that makes you and I important is God. Period. Nothing else. You see, and yet he's the one that we neglect by going after the same things the world goes after. Food, clothing, shelter, all these other things, the pleasures of life. He's already mentioned all these things about treasures. And you and I go after these things and we show ourselves, rather than showing that we have a heavenly Father, we act just like the world when it comes to tragedy and trial and different things. And really the truth of the matter is, we ought to show the world. Now, folks, listen. Can I tell you something? Faith and trust in God can really look arrogant, especially to the world. Now, here's the problem. Oftentimes, in our faith, in our trust in God, we are arrogant. And God doesn't want us to be arrogant and boastful about ourselves, and listen to me, and about our faith. I'm telling you, we made a drastic mistake down through the years, or the last 30, 40 years. A lot of people have faith in their faith. And then when their faith fails, they fail. God's never called us to have faith in our faith. God has called us to have faith in God. You see, that's what's important. There's a lot of people that put on the appearance, right? The outward appearance at times that we have faith in God and trust in God. But really, it's faith in our own faith. And God has to teach us that. And how does he do that? As George Mueller said, they asked him about his faith and how his trust was developed with God. And he said, you know what he said? Through trials. God bringing me through great trials that I might trust him more. And listen, when you decide and you make up your mind and you see what Jesus is going to say here at the end of verse number 30, he says, shall he, God, not much more, you see that? Clothe you, O ye of little faith. This is so important, folks. Why? It is not that you can't clothe yourself. You can. You have the ability to do it on your own. Am I telling the truth? Amen. Now again, ultimately we know anything still, God is God-given. But you can choose, again, to clothe yourself and do everything your own way. Right? But you're missing out on the much more. You see, it's so much better to depend upon God doing it than depending upon yourself. You know why? Because self is going to one day run out. There's going to be a day, and this is very hard. You know, we have in our church men that are in their 80s working, Paul and some of these other men just still going at it. But it's coming a day, and I hate to tell Paul this, but it's coming a day. You're probably not going to be able to do it again.
Sooner than later.
It's just going to happen, right? And guess what? You're going to hate it, but you're going to have to depend on somebody else other than yourself. And so what's best is, as God gives you the ability to do these things, understanding everything you do and able to do comes from God, and give him the glory and give him the credit. Right. And you know what will happen? When you're not able to do it, you'll understand it's just your time. You weren't dependent upon yourself when you were. Now, you'll find out a lot about yourself, folks. Y'all realize that, right? We find out a lot about ourselves when we can't do things anymore.
Amen.
Then we realize, my goodness, have I been dependent upon myself all this time? You don't want to come to that place. You want to come to that place right now and say, God, if I'm there, help me. I want to depend upon you because there's coming a day where I can't depend upon myself. And the truth of the matter is, I really can't depend on myself anyway.
Amen.
You see, it's just logical to understand. Now, see what Jesus said here. Did he say, O ye of no faith? No, because that would be the world. That would be the lost man. Right? They had faith, but it was just little faith. Right? This is where they were. But this is not where God wanted them to stay. You get it? He wanted to bring them along. And of course, the rest, and we're going to pick up the message next Sunday, Lord willing. But see, the rest of the passage of Scripture is going to go along with this because, listen, everybody asks, how can I increase my faith? We're going to talk about that next week. I'm not sure what time it is. I think you're getting out a little early today, probably. How can I increase my faith? How can I have not little faith, but how can I have greater faith? The rest of the verses are going to tell us. Getting to know God and trusting the Lord Jesus Christ is the only way. There is no other way. It's relinquishing, again, your control over every circumstance. Understanding that, again, God has gone from the lesser to the greater. If he takes care of the fowls, if he takes care of the flowers, if he takes care of the grass, and he put all these details and all these things, surely, surely, amen, the logical conclusion is, he can take care of me. I may not see it. I may not understand it. But he can take care of me. And I need to depend upon him. Not myself. Not somebody else. That's why it's so important, folks. Listen. Do you realize you could be dependent upon someone? You know, I've seen it with missionaries and with pastors, and same thing, vice versa, husbands and wives, and they depended so much on their wife or their husband, and then when they die, they're devastated. Nobody should ever be devastated when somebody else dies, humanly speaking, in your life. The only way you should be devastated is if God dies, and he's not dying. He died once, he was buried, and he rose again. Amen. I'm going to tell you, we're dependent upon people and things. And a lot of times people are dependent upon jobs and just different things in life. And when that's taken away from you, it's so hard to cope, isn't it? Right? In life. That's why God's saying, you have a heavenly Father. It's just logical. You can depend upon him. Because he created everything else. And you are greater than everything else that he created.
Amen.
Isn't that amazing? Amen. Isn't that wonderful? That God does care. He took very great care. Now, I tell you, I for one, I love green grass. Man, I just love grass. And now, I really, I'm not fond of Bermuda grass. But I am fond of its resilience. If you look at half of my grass at my house is Bermuda grass. And it started with a patch. Even if you know about Bermuda grass, buddy, it'll take over, man. And most people hate it. But I love it right now. In this heat without water, man, it just does a good job. You go by my house today. And man, you look at the upper part of my grass and on the side of the house, oh my goodness, it's green. Beautiful. You know, but wintertime's going to come. It's going to be so ugly. I mean, it's going to die out. It goes dormant. And some people hate that stuff. I just say it's part of the seasons. But I love it right now. And just think about all the grasses that God created and all these things and how he made it so. And yet we get so worried. And that's the whole thought of the message, isn't it? Take no thought. Do not have anxiety. Right? Paul said it like this, and we said it 2 weeks ago. Be careful for nothing, but in everything, with prayer and thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. And then what does he say? In the peace of God, which passes what? All understanding. You ain't going to understand it Why are you going to try? If God told you you wasn't going to understand it, why are you going to try to understand it? Well, I just don't understand. Right? So he says, really, don't be thinking, because you're not really thinking. When you're thinking that I'm not going to be taken care of. But you're really thinking, when you think, I have a Heavenly Father that's taking care of everything else. And I'm more important, according to God, than everything else. And so will He not take care of me? Amen? Isn't that the message for today in our society that we're in right now? Folks, listen, I don't know about you. We're in turmoil. Listen, do you realize that Antichrist, this is right on the bend. Now, you got even Christians. Now, folks, listen. You got Christians thinking that by taking the vaccine or doing this stuff that they took taking the mark of the beast. I mean, you got people thinking, listen, they don't know their Bibles. Now, is all this stuff a setup? Yes, it is a setup. All these different things are set up for the coming day where Jesus is going to come. He's going to rapture us out of here. And we're not going to have the ability to take the mark of the beast. That's why we need to know the Bible. Amen.
Amen.
We don't have that capability to take the mark of the beast today. We are not in the tribulation period. Now, I know there's some people out there that think we are. But I still say we're not, according to the Bible. Amen. So, should I be sitting there concerned about this and that? No, I need to be concerned. Again, yes, I should be concerned, okay, for people's lost souls. Amen. And that God wants them to be saved, okay, and wants them to hear the truth of the Word of God. Amen. That's what we need. That's what we need. But the problem is, you and I act as if we don't have a Heavenly Father to take care of us, right? In the midst of all this mess that we're in, we got to go back and say, God, please help me. It's just logical, God, that I trust you. You take care of everything else. Matter of fact, I wouldn't even be here, God, if you wouldn't have made me. Is that not true? God made you and He made me. He has a purpose. Help us. So stand to our feet. No invitation. Just you take these message home. I pray again that you will listen to the Word of God. Take no thought. Take no thought. Don't have anxiety over what everything's going on in the world. Realize that God is in control. His plan will take place. And you and I need to follow Him in all that we do. And trust Him. Let's pray. Father, we're grateful for the service today. Thank you for letting us come. Thank you for giving us the health and the strength to be able to be here. Father, we know that you are protecting us. You are watching over us. God, we know there is many. We've seen people. Really over the last 6, 7, 8 months, people dying and going on to be with you. And Father, ultimately, that's a great thing. Paul says in the Scriptures, and we know it to be true, it'd be better to go to be with you than to stay here. But it's not better for those that pass this life without you. And so, God, we pray that you'd help us to be a witness and a testimony that you're our Father and that you want us to help others to stay true to you and you alone. We pray this in Jesus' wonderful name. His sake. And all God's people said,
amen.
Amen. And God bless you. Amen.